This question is a little more lengthy. It might require a slightly longer answer, perhaps. What is it that the Bible refers to, which appears in the book Daniel, and I think in Matthew, that terrible image which stands before God that will come back to earth?
Yeah, there's a couple answers to that, and it's a little bit difficult. The question is a little vague, but the Bible does mention in the book of Daniel, chapter 24, something called the abomination of desolation. It also mentions that in Daniel, the abomination of desolation. The word abomination simply means something that defiles. And desolation, it's the defiling image. And if you look in Revelation, it talks about the mark of the beast, this defiling image. It's talking about a time when religious confederation unites. There's a false religious power and unites under the beast power, and the false religious powers unite with the state power to oppress God's people. It's a desolating, defiling power that represents humanity in a great confederation to stand against God. I have a number of lectures on that in Revelation that we'll be talking about as the lectures go on. So stay with me on that. That question's so good, it's going to take about 2 to 3 hours to answer it. And we will do that as the lecture period goes on.
We can look forward to that.
Well, now let's bow our heads together and pray as we go into our lecture for today. Father, thank you for this audience in Melbourne. Thank you night after night as they come to hear your word, that their hearts are open to Jesus. As we study this important topic today about why would a loving God allow suffering and sickness and death, as we study about this angelic conflict of good and evil, we pray that you'd give us wisdom that is more than human, and come and be with us and open our hearts to your will. In Christ's name, amen. My topic today is the titanic struggle between good and evil, angels in the Bible, and a loving God allowing suffering, sickness, and death. You know, angels are having a comeback today. More and more books are being written on angels. Life magazine wrote a feature story on angels. You can read book after book today on angels. There are also angel pins and angel statuettes and little angel icons, angel necklaces. Angels seem to be appearing everywhere today. Even in movies, Meryl Streep, famous American actress, starred in Angels in America. You may have seen in Australia the movies on sports and angels, Angels in the Outfield. It's a baseball movie. We don't have that as much here in Australia, but angels are appearing in movies. A very famous CBS series called Touched by an Angel. Did you have that down here in Australia? Some say, yes, you did. Touched by an Angel, stories about angels. So angels are in books, angels are in magazines, angels are appearing on little necklaces around the neck, angels in television. Angels seem to be popping up everywhere. Of course, angels are quite prominent in the book of Revelation. You can't read the book of Revelation without coming face to face with angels. In Revelation chapter 1, an angel comes to John, the aged apostle on the island of Patmos, and shares with him heavenly visions about the future. In Revelation chapter 2 and 3, the Bible talks about the history of the Christian church, and it talks about the church in every age down through the centuries. In Revelation 2 and verse 3, talks about the message of the angels that is recorded in Scripture for those churches down through the centuries. Revelation chapter 7 talks about terrible strife and conflict coming upon this world, and it talks about the angels there holding back those winds of strife and conflict. Revelation chapter 10 talks about a solemn announcement to go to the world made by an angelic figure who brings that announcement to John on the island of Patmos. Revelation chapter 14 talks about the most important message ever to come to humanity, but it's symbolically pictured as being carried by angels. When you open the Bible and read the book of Revelation, there are angels everywhere. Revelation seems to be a book of angels, a book of good angels and a book of evil angels, a book of the powers of good and the powers of evil. Revelation 16 talks about 7 plagues, judgments poured out upon this world by angels. Revelation 18 is God's final call before the coming of Jesus, and it's being pictured as given symbolically by angels. When you come to the book of Revelation, Revelation reveals a struggle between good and evil. But don't you feel that struggle in your own heart? Don't you sense in your own life at times that you want to do good, but you're pulled to do evil? Don't you sense at times what you ought to do, and then you sense an inability to do what you want to do? We see that those forces of good and evil in our world. We see the sun that we lie on in the beach and get a tan. But we also see that sun giving us a drought here in Victoria and in Melbourne. And we see it parching the crops. We see the same sun that ripens grain destroying cornfields and grain fields. When you look at nature, there is good and there's bad. There's the breeze that cools you, but it's also the hurricane breeze that destroys cities and destroys towns. We look around us today, and every place we see, from within our own hearts, there's good and evil. In the universe, there's good and evil. In the world, there's good and evil. We see in the world love, but we also see hate. We see kindness, but we also see greed and selfishness. We see giving in the world, but we also see taking in the world. So Revelation reveals this struggle between good and evil. And Revelation helps us to pull the curtain aside, and it helps us to look into the heart of the universe and understand where evil came from. The Bible talks about a struggle between the angels that are loyal to God and angels that are disloyal to God. But that leads us to a question. Why is there war on earth? Why is there suffering on earth? Why is there heartache on earth? Why is there sorrow on earth? The book of Revelation gives us a glimpse of the why of suffering, and it helps us understand where evil came from. Revelation 12, verse 7 to 9 says, "And war broke out in heaven." Where was the first war? The first war was where? Where does it say? War broke out in heaven. Now, isn't that a strange place for war? Isn't heaven a strange place for a war to begin? Could it be that the reason there are wars on earth is because there was first a war in heaven? Could it be that the reason there are conflicts on earth because there was first a conflict in heaven? And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. The Bible sweeps the curtain aside and describes a titanic struggle between good and evil. The great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. The Bible introduces this war, this conflict between good and evil. It points out that the dragon, the devil, led one-third of the angels in rebellion against God. But that leads us to a question. Where did this demonic angel come from? Did God create a devil? Why was there war in heaven? Where did this dragon come from? If God created this evil angel, wouldn't God be responsible for all evil? Did God make a mistake when he created this angel? Did God create a devil? Did God create some defect in his mind so that he rebelled? If all of conflict, all of war, all of strife, all of sin, if all the sorrow and difficulty and horror that comes upon the world finds its root or origin in an angel in heaven that fell and rebelled against God and led a third of the angels to rebel against God, and then this angel and his followers were cast out of heaven, if we can trace back to all of the suffering of our world, to this fallen angel, can't we trace it right back to God? Because did God create this angel with some kind of defect? Let's notice what the Bible says. We go to the book of Ezekiel to help us understand where this fallen angel came from and the origin of this fallen angel. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 12 says, "Thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty." So when the Bible describes this fallen angel, it says he was the seal of perfection. He was full of wisdom. He was perfect in beauty. So God did not create a demonic angel. God did not create a defect in this fallen angel. Rather, God created an angel that was perfect in beauty. The Bible says you were the anointed cherub. Somebody give me another name for a cherub. What's that? Another name for a cherub. Angel, that's right. You were the anointed angel. So here is an angel that God anointed. An angel created in dazzling brightness. An angel that has the freedom or the capacity to choose. An angel with no defect. An angel that stood with the other angels worshiping and praising God. It said, you're the anointed angel who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. Here's a magnificent, glorious angel that God himself created. And the Bible says you were perfect in the ways, in your ways from the day you were created. Did God create a flaw? Did God make a mistake when he created this angel? Did he? Not at all. What does the Bible say? You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created until iniquity was found in you. What is this iniquity? What's another word for iniquity? Sin or rebellion. So he was perfect till sin or rebellion was found in him. So God created this angelic being perfect. But this angelic being had the power of choice. God gave him the capacity of choice. Somebody said, wait a minute. Why did God give him the capacity of choice? Why didn't God just create him so he couldn't have fallen? Why didn't God create him so he couldn't have rebelled? Why didn't God create him in a way that he could not choose? Look, if you take away the capacity to choose, you take away the opportunity to love, because love can never be coerced. Love can never be forced. So if you can't choose, you can't what? Love. And if you cannot love, you cannot be fully happy. So God did not want to create some robot creature that could not choose. But if you give beings the possibility to choose, they might make the right choice. Or they may make the wrong choice. Once you give them the possibility to choose, they can either make the right choice or the wrong choice, right? So God gave angels the capacity to choose because he didn't want programmed angels. Notice what the Bible says, Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 17. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. So this angel that God created perfect, this angel that God created with the freedom of choice, this angel corrupted his own beauty. God did not corrupt him. He corrupted his own beauty by his own choice because his pride and arrogance led him to want to be like God. When you look at this fallen angel, you discover that he made a choice. Now, let's look at it this way. Let's suppose you're the father of a lovely daughter, and she doesn't always make the right choices. She's a little girl, and let's suppose God gives you a choice. He said, I'll tell you what to do. You're never going to have to worry again about telling your little daughter, pick up your room and clean up after yourself. You're never going to have to worry again about telling your little daughter to study. This is what we're going to do. I'm going to give you a child that is a robot child. Your child has two screws, one on each side of the head. All you have to do every morning is take these screws out, flip up the top of the head, and put a computer chip in. And every morning you program the child from the computer. And every morning the child will say, Mommy, Daddy, I love you. You program the kid in the computer, that's all. Mommy, Daddy, I will eat my Australian Weetabix. Every morning a kid does that. Not Kellogg's Weetabix. Mommy, Daddy, every day I will study my lessons and I will study so hard I will get A's. How would you like a kid like that? Raise your hand. Don't raise your hand too quickly, please. 7 people raise their hand. They're the ones that have kids. Now look, you don't want a child like that, do you? Do you think God wanted to take angels in some cosmic computer someplace, computerize all those angels? You think God wanted to do that? Not at all. So God created angels with the freedom of choice. But once God did that, they could make the wrong choice Because God didn't want love to be forced. God didn't want to have these little robots or these little mannequins, these little puppet people, that God is up there and he's some cosmic grandfather and he's kind of pulling strings. Whoop! Up goes an arm. Whoop! The other one's going to go obey. Up goes a leg. So God gave us the freedom of choice. Why? Because he wanted us to know his character. He wanted us to love him for who he is, not because we were manipulated or controlled to do it. And so, one of those angels rebelled against God. What happened in that angel's mind? Isaiah chapter 14, 12 to 14 tells us what was going on in the mind of Lucifer. God created angels. He created this angel perfect. How are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? The word Lucifer comes from two Latin words, lux meaning light, fera meaning bearer. So Lucifer is a light bearer. He's a magnificent angel. How are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? For you have said in your heart, you see, sin always begins in the heart. Rebellion always begins in the mind. You have said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. Wasn't he already in heaven? Sure, but he wants a place higher than God's. I'll ascend into heaven. I'll exalt my throne above the stars of God. Do you see the picture? Is the picture beginning to emerge? God creates a perfect angel. That angel looks at his own glory and splendor. He thinks that he's given himself that splendor or glory. That angel decides that he wants a throne that is higher than God's throne. He doesn't want to obey. He wants to command. He doesn't want to listen. He wants to issue divine decrees. He says in his heart, I'll ascend into heaven. I'll exalt my throne above the stars of God. I'll sit upon the mount of the congregation in the farthest sides of the north. What's the mount of the congregation in the farthest sides of the north? It is the mount from which God gave the law. So what is this angel saying? He's saying, I don't want to obey the law. I want to rather be the lawgiver. I want to be the one that is worshipped. I'll ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. So here is an angel, a created being, a being created to worship God and find his joy in worshiping God. But he says, I will be like the Most High. He wants to have an exalted position. He wants to be superior in all the universe. And the Bible tells us the story that the center of sin is I. It is egotism. It is pride. And any time we live lives independent of God, any time we live egotistical lives where the I is the number one, Jesus Christ invites us to come to him and find in him our source of joy and peace. Lucifer exalted himself. Lucifer desired a higher position. Lucifer desired an exalted throne. Lucifer desired rulership and dominance. So there was a great controversy, a Star Wars conflict. It was the war of the worlds. What would God do? Love is the foundation of God's government. And Lucifer said, God does not love. God issues commands. Lucifer began to sow his disaffection, sow his lies among other angels. He said, we should be free. He said, follow me and you'll be happier. And so there was, for the first time in heaven, disharmony. For the first time in heaven, there was discord. And angels had to take a side. A line was drawn in the sand. Lucifer would use lies. He would use jealousy. He would use any tactic he could. But God would only use one thing to attract his creatures, and that was love. God would not use force. God would not use coercion. God would not use pressure. God would only use love. Love is the foundation of God's government. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, God is love. So God's character is a loving character. God would reveal to all heavenly beings, all angelic beings, how much he loved them. As he did, Satan continued these lies, and Satan continued to sow his disaffection. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 6, you have set your heart as the heart of a god. Lucifer said, I've set my heart on being God. I will do anything I can to destroy God and throw him off his throne. I will use lies and deceit and pressure and coercion. Lucifer questioned God's authority. He began talking to the other angels. He said, does God really have your interest in view? Does God really want you to be happy? Does God really want you filled with joy? They began to have doubts in their own mind. Lucifer questioned God's fairness. It's not fair that we have to obey. It's not fair that we have to worship him. It's not fair that we have to praise him. Lucifer saw God as a rival, and he knew that he had to get rid of God or try to do that. How would God face Lucifer's challenge? Why didn't God just stamp out Lucifer? Why didn't God say, that's it, you've rebelled in heaven, I'm just going to squash you like a mosquito, just snap it. I'm going to just kill you like an ant. I'm just going to get rid of you. God was challenged by a rival. God was challenged by an angelic being, a being that had a certain amount of respect by the other angels. God was challenged by a rival. Let's suppose, for example, that God did destroy this Lucifer. And you raise the question, why not destroy evil before it had a chance to spread? Why not just destroy it? Well, let's suppose that there is a politician here on the right of the screen. And let's suppose some young guy comes along and he begins challenging this politician. He says, you're dishonest. He said, you don't have the best of the Australian people in view. He said, the way your government is going is corrupt. He brings all these charges. Let's suppose that the head of the nation, who commands the special forces, says, okay, I'll bring the special forces out and I'll just totally destroy my rival. I'll just totally annihilate my rival. That'll solve the problem. If a political official is challenged, and if because he has the power, he can bring out the special forces and annihilate the rival, that proves he's innocent, right? What do you think? If I use my power to destroy my rival, if I have that power, it does not prove my innocence. It rather does what? Confirms my guilt, correct? So if God would have destroyed Satan, what would have happened? The whole universe would have been so fearful, they said maybe God destroyed him because Satan's claims against God were right. So what would God do? God is challenged. His government is challenged. His fairness is challenged. His love is challenged. God would allow time to go on and give every being in the universe, every angelic being, the opportunity to see love and its results and to choose it forever through all eternity and to see hate and greed and its results and choose it. The question raised was, is God really just? Is his way really best? So God wanted the universe to see that the way of love was best. Lucifer and the evil angels were cast out of heaven. The Bible says in Revelation 12, verse 9, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan who deceives the whole world. He was cast out into the earth and his angels were cast out with him. Wait a minute, somebody says. I have a question. Although the universe must see that God is love and his way is best, how did planet Earth become involved in this cosmic conflict? Did God just create Earth as a dumping off place for Satan? Did God just create Earth because he said, look, I got to get rid of Satan. I don't want him up here anymore anyway. I'm just going to send him down there to hassle those people on Earth. Was Earth created as a dumping off place for Satan? Not at all. The Bible tells us, in fact, that when God created this world, he created it perfect. He created it without a taint of sickness or sin or suffering or disease. The Bible says that when God created Earth, in the book of Genesis, that it was perfect as he created it. So this earth was not created as a dumping off place, a place for God to get rid of Satan. But wait a minute. If God would have isolated earth and not allowed Adam and Eve to make a choice, Satan would have cried foul. Satan would have cried unfair. Satan would have cried, wait a minute, God, if you give Adam and Eve the choice to serve me, they would serve me. So God must, to be fair, give Adam and Eve the same choice that every other being had. God would reveal his love to Adam and Eve. God would reveal his goodness to them. God would put them in a magnificent garden. But they, too, must make their choice. And so God said to Adam and Eve, a deceiver will come. He will entice you at the tree. He will say that if you eat of that tree, you'll enter into a new exhilarated life of joy and happiness. But do not listen to the deceiver, because if you partake of that tree in rebellion against me, it will represent self-centeredness and egotism. My way of love is the way of joy and happiness. the intruder came. And he came to Eve at that tree. And as he came to her, he enticed her in the form of a snake or a serpent. And he said to Eve, Eve, partake of the tree. Eve, God is holding something back from you. Eve, God is restrictive. God is a tyrant. He's a vindictive judge. Eve, God doesn't want you to be happy. Eve, take of the tree. You're not going to die. Oh, but if I take of this tree, I'll be separated from God. If I take of this tree, I'll die. Genesis 3, 4, and 5. You will not surely die. Partake of the tree. For God knows, Satan said, that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. And you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. If you partake of this tree, Satan speaking through the serpent said, first spiritualistic medium in the Garden of Eden. First lie was about death. You can sin and you won't die. Eve, you're naturally immortal. There's no way you can die. Eve, you don't depend on God for your immortality. You have immortality in yourself, Eve. Partake of the tree, Eve, and you'll be like God. Quickly, she partook of that tree. And as she did, she gave it to Adam. He partook of it. And the seeds of sin flowed into their body. They rebelled against God. They followed the way of selfishness. They followed the way of greed. They listened to the voice of Lucifer rather than listening to the voice of God. And as they left that garden, the first family argument took place in the garden. God came there, and Eve said, the serpent made me do it. And Adam said, my wife made me do it. Arguing, debating. Now something strange happened to their heart. The love they had was gone. Their hearts now became selfish. Now anger and bitterness developed. Because sin produces anxiety, and sin produces fear, and sin produces suffering, and sin produces death. You see, God is the source of life, and when you're separated from God, death flows into your body. We don't have life naturally. God is the source of love, and when you're separated from God, hatred and anxiety flows your body. God is the source of peace, and when you're separated from God, worry fills your life. God is the source of goodness and kindness, and when you're separated from God, selfishness and greed come. So when Adam and Eve left that garden home, they were separated from God. And as the result of that, sickness and suffering and death and horror came upon the human race. Somebody said, but wait a minute. You mean we are all in this mess because of Adam and Eve's sin? They led the human race into sin, but you and I have sinned, and every other human being has sinned as well. And so we see a world filled with selfishness and greed, a world that is separated from God, and ours is a planet in rebellion. And so this world separated from God and separated from its original plan experiences hurricane, typhoons, and floods. Why? Because we're separated from the one who can keep it all under control. It experiences sickness, disease, and death. Why? Because we're separated from one who is the fountain of health and the fountain of life. It shows us greed and rebellion. And so we see a world that's incredibly deep trouble, a world that's filled with suffering, a world that's filled with want, a world that's filled with some people that have a lot and other people that have nothing, a world that's filled with people that have multi-million dollar mansions, some of them, and other people that can't find a home even lying on a gravestone. Yes, we live in a world where sin has ravaged it. We live in a world where bombs drop and soldiers shoot their guns and innocents often suffer. We live in a world where disease takes our young and it ravages our bodies. We live in a world where graves dot the landscape. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. What does the whole universe see right now? The whole universe sees our planet, a planet in rebellion, a planet that has chosen to rebel against God. And when you contrast that before the heavenly world, where there is no sickness and suffering and death, where loyal angels to God and loyal heavenly beings worship around his throne, the whole universe sees that conflict between good and evil. Who is responsible for the sickness, the suffering, and death in our world? Certainly not God. A rebel angel chose to rebel against God, and human beings chose to rebel against him. Jesus told a story. The disciples came to him, and they said, if God is a God of love, why is there so much suffering and sorrow in our world? Where did it all come from? And Jesus said, let me tell you a story. One day a sower went out to sow. He was going to sow seeds in his field, and he, as the wise sower, representing God, sowed only good seed. But later at night, an enemy came, and he sowed bad seed, and weeds and tares grew up together. Matthew chapter 13, verse 27, somebody says to him, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" That's what we ask. Where'd the evil come from? Where'd the heartache come from? Where'd the sorrow come from? What has he said? He said, an enemy has done this. The Bible teaches that there's an enemy. An enemy between God, an enemy against God, an enemy against man. His name is the devil, Lucifer. He was the dragon. He led Adam and Eve into sin. He led the human race into sin. He is the evil one. He is the one responsible behind the sickness, suffering, and death in our world today. Many people picture the devil as a being with horns in some kind of red suit and a pitchfork in the center of the earth in flames. But ladies and gentlemen, he's much more cunning than that. He was once a brilliant angel who lived in heaven. There is a conflict between good and evil angels in the universe. Our planet is caught in the midst of a titanic and unusual struggle between the forces of right and the forces of wrong, between the angels of good and the angels of hell here in this planet. Now that leads us, though, to a question. What is Satan's ultimate fate? Why doesn't God do something if he's a God of love about the evil? Satan led one-third of the angels to rebel. We see that conflict today. They were cast out of heaven. They came knocking on the door of planet Earth, and Adam and Eve, in their rebellion, our first parents, wanted to keep a door shut. But we should not condemn them because we too have walked in the way of evil. We too have walked in the way of rebellion against God. We too have walked in the way of sin. Adam and Eve left that garden. But before they did, you ask the question, why doesn't God do something about the evil if he's a God of love? Three things. First, God has already done something. Second, God is now doing something. Thirdly, God will yet do something. First, let's look at what happened. When Adam and Eve sinned, God gave them a garden promise. God didn't say to Adam and Eve, "Look, you sinned. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to push the planet Earth far into space, and I'm going to exile it, quarantine it in the universe, destroy all life on planet Earth, and start over again." Is that what God said? When Adam and Eve sinned, did he say, "I'm going to destroy all life on planet Earth and start over again"? Not at all. When Adam and Eve sinned, God came to that garden, and he called their name. Adam, Eve, where are you? Adam, Eve, I love you with an incredible love. I love you too much to let you go. Adam and Eve, I'm going to give you a promise in this garden. I'm going to give you a promise. And here's the promise given by God in Genesis 3, verse 15. He says, "I'll put enmity," that's a separation, "between you and the woman." He looks at Satan, the snake, and he says to Satan, "I'm going to put enmity. I'm going to separate you between you and this woman that you've deceived, between your offspring and hers." Then he says, "And he," that is the Messiah, "will come, and he's going to crush your head, but you'll strike his heel." Satan struck at Jesus on the cross. A striking the heel represents symbolically in the Bible a blow that is not deadly. Striking your head is a deadly blow. So here in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve sinned, our Lord came and he said to them, Satan is going to receive a deadly blow. The wages of sin is death, but the Messiah is going to come. The Savior is going to come. The Redeemer is going to come. And as the Redeemer comes, he will strike a deadly blow to Satan when he dies on the cross for the sins of humanity. Jesus took Adam and Eve, and there in the garden, they were to offer an animal sacrifice. That sacrifice was to point forward to the coming of Jesus. You say, "It's terrible. Why did those lambs have to die back there? I think that's the most gross. That's the most detectable. That's awful." It is awful. Sin brings death. The death of every animal pointed forward to something far more terrible than an animal's death. The blood of animals pointed far more to something far more terrible than the blood of those animals itself. It pointed to the blood of Christ. Jesus said to Adam, "Take an animal." Can you imagine Adam the first time? He had never seen death before. He had never any idea what death was. And he took some kind of flint knife that he had sharpened, some stone, and he brought that animal. And the animal knew no fear. The animal knew no anxiety. And he slit that animal's throat, and the blood squirted out all over his leg. And Jesus said to him, this blood represents my blood that will be shed. This death of the animal represents my death. And so down through the ages, believers came looking forward to the time that Christ would die, that he would take the shame and the guilt and the agony of their sin upon himself. And in the stream of time, when the Bible says the fullness of time would come, Mary brought forth the Christ child. And the child conceived in her womb was conceived of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus grew in wisdom and strength. He faced Satan's temptations head on. Jesus did not yield. He lived the righteous, godly life that you and I should have lived. He died the death that we should have died. Jesus says, Jeremiah 31, verse 3, through the prophet, yes, I've loved you with an everlasting love. The rebel angel in heaven said, God does not love you. The rebel angel in heaven said, God is unjust. The rebel angel in heaven said, God is unfair. The rebel angel in heaven said, follow me. But Jesus said, I will reveal my love. I will come to earth. I will walk over the same ground that Adam and Eve went over. I will face Satan's temptations just like Adam and Eve faced them. I will be victorious over Satan where Adam and Eve failed. They deserve death. I will take the penalty upon myself. I will be betrayed. I will be forsaken. I will be cast off. I will have nails driven through my hands. I will hang on a cross with the guilt of all humanity upon me, with the condemnation of sin upon me. I will hang there and cry out, my God, why will you have you forsaken me? Because on the cross, there was a judgment bar set up. On the cross, Jesus Christ was judged as a sinner. On the cross, Jesus Christ was judged as and condemned. And before the whole universe, he stood condemned. Why? The Bible says, Galatians 3, verse 13, cursed is everyone that hangs on the tree. He was cursed not because he sinned, but because we sinned. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, he who knew no sin, did Jesus ever sin? No. He who knew no sin became sin for us. Did Jesus ever sin? No. But he became sin. He became sin for you and me, and he hung on that cross, and he exposed Satan's lies. He exposed Satan's falsehoods. He exposed Satan's deceptions, because hanging on that cross before the whole universe, Satan received a death blow, because from that cross echoes and re-echoes God is love. He is such love that he will not have you be lost. He's such love that he would die so that you could have eternal life. Why doesn't God do something about the sin problem? He has. He has come and lived in the human flesh. He has taken on Satan in his human flesh. He has defeated Satan. Ladies and gentlemen, Satan is a defeated foe. Jesus already defeated him. Satan is a defeated foe. Death has already been vanquished. You and I need not fear death, because although the wages of sin is death, Jesus Christ has paid those wages. You and I can go free. Why doesn't Jesus do something? He has, but he is going to yet do something, because he is not simply the Christ of the tomb. He is the resurrected Christ. He came out of the tomb. Revelation reveals love's response. Revelation 1, verse 5, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, we're washed, we're cleansed, we come. And the blood of Christ was shed for our sins. The nails went through his hands, went there for us. Why doesn't God do something if he loves us? He has done something. He has. He came as a baby. He vanquished Satan. He died on the cross. He overcame where Adam and Eve failed. Lucifer challenged God, and God met the challenge, not with force, not with coercion, but with love. You say, how do I know God loves me? And he says, look at the nails in my hands. He said, look at the sacrifice I made on the cross. This is love's sacrifice. Never again does the universe have to question God's love. But he did not remain in that tomb when the angel descended. He said, son, your father calls you. The Roman soldiers fell over like dead men. The brightness of God's glory illuminated the tomb, and Christ ascended from the dead. Where is he today? Why doesn't he do something with my suffering? Why doesn't he do something when my child has faced death? Why doesn't he do something when I'm going through a divorce? Why doesn't God do something? I'm in the midst of this world of evil and I didn't choose it. He has already done something. He died so you could have eternal life. But he is now yet doing something. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 and 16. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. But he was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly before the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Why doesn't Jesus do something? I'm in the midst of a world of suffering. Why doesn't Jesus do something? I'm in the midst of a world of sorrow. Jesus died and was resurrected. He lives in heaven now. Because he came to earth, he understands all your sorrow. He understands all your disappointment. He understands all your heartache. He understands all your grief. We can come to him to find grace, that is strength and mercy in our times of need. What time of need are you going through today? Do you say, nobody understands me? I'm going through real heartache, a broken heart today. I'm going through real disappointment. Nobody understands me today. Jesus came. He experienced everything that you'll ever experience. The devil threw at him all of his temptations in much greater degree and greater power than you could possibly imagine. Jesus understands what you are going through. And he's there to help in your time of need. A number of years ago, this little boy who was living in the farmlands of Canada, and he would deliver papers out to farmers. And he'd bring those papers out to them, newspapers, and he'd deliver them. And this little boy always wanted a dog. And he really wanted a golden retriever, one of those beautiful golden retriever dogs. And he decided, I'm going to save up my money. He saved $25, so you couldn't buy a golden retriever puppy for that today, probably. They're much more expensive, but in those days you could. It was a number of years ago. And so the little boy always wanted a golden retriever. And as he was riding his bike one day, he'd ride his bike, deliver newspapers, ride his bike, deliver newspapers. He saw a sign in front of a little farm that said, golden retriever puppies for sale. And the little boy thought, great. He dropped his bike, ran up on the porch, and he saw an old farmer rocking back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And he said, you got golden retriever puppies? The farmer said, yeah, I do. How much are they? $25. The boy said, look, I got it, sir. I got it. I saved up $25. I've always wanted a golden retriever puppy. The farmer said, sure, I've got a number of puppies, and let me whistle. The mother will come running when I whistle around the barn, and you'll see the puppies. So the man whistled. And here, you didn't know I could whistle, did you? Here comes the golden retriever around the farmhouse and had all the four little puppies behind it. The little puppies, you know, the little legs are running and tumbling over and running. And the little boy sat down and the mama dog came over and licked his face and the little puppies began climbing up on his knees and he was hugging this little puppy. Do I want this puppy or do I want this puppy or do I want that puppy? And he played with him, oh, for the longest little time. Right after that, he noticed another little puppy coming right around the farmhouse. And this little puppy was dragging its leg and dragging its leg and dragging its leg. And the little boy said, what's the matter with that puppy? Oh, the farmer said, that puppy has a crooked leg. It was born that way. It was the runt of the litter. What are you going to do with that puppy, sir? I'm going to take a gun and go out and put a bullet in its head. That puppy's no good for anything. Nobody would ever buy that puppy. Nobody would ever buy that puppy. It's no good for anything. I'm going to shoot it. I can't take care of it. The little boy said, sir, I got $25. I want to buy that puppy. You're crazy. You're going to have to care for that puppy all of its life. Here are four puppies. Choose one of these. I am going to buy that puppy. Here's my $25. The farmer looked at the little boy and he said, why in the world are you ever going to buy that puppy? And the boy got up and he began to walk toward the farmer. And the farmer noticed the limp in the boy's leg. And the boy walked over to the farmer, he pulled up his pant leg, and there were the telltale signs of a metal brace. And the boy looked up and he said, I've had polio ever since the time I was born. And that little puppy is going to need somebody that understands, and I do. I need somebody that understands me when I'm lonely. I need somebody that understands me when I'm discouraged. I need somebody that understands me when my heart is broken. I need somebody that understands me when I'm overwhelmed with temptation that's so big in my life I can't handle it. And Jesus does. And Jesus does. Why doesn't Jesus do something about the evil and the sin and the sickness in our world? He has. He came to die. He is yet doing something. He is not in the tomb. He is the living Christ, who the Bible says, let us therefore come boldly, that means confidently, to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Do you have some time of need today? In the midst of a world of sickness and suffering and heartache and sorrow, Jesus Christ has not left you alone. In the midst of a world of disappointment, he is there for you. You and I need somebody that understands, and he does. Somebody that we can kneel before and share the essence of our hearts with, to share the brokenness of our life with, to share the trauma and the sorrow that we don't want to experience and express to anybody else. He is there for you. He is there for me. When we have temptations that seem to be overwhelming, when habits grip our lives that we seem not to be able to deal with, he is there. He understands, because Jesus Christ already has fought Satan and he already has won. By faith, I can say, Jesus, you already battled Satan. By faith, I can say, Jesus, you already won the victory. By faith, I can say, Jesus, I know that you are the living Christ. You'll change, forever change my heart to give me strength. The Bible says in Isaiah 41, verse 10, fear not. Jesus said, for I'm with you. What are you going through today, my friend? What heartache, what sorrow, what disappointment, what temptations? Jesus says, he's not left you alone. You're not a plaything of the devil. Fear not, for I'm with you. Be not dismayed or confused, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. When you're weak, he says, I'll strengthen you. When you feel you can't hang on any longer, he says, I'll strengthen you. When you're about ready to give up, he says, I'll strengthen you. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. Do you need help? This is Jesus. He says, I'll help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. He is the living Christ. Why does not God do something about the suffering and sickness in our world? He has. He sent Jesus. He defeated Satan. He paid the eternal price for your salvation and mine. He revealed God's love. He answered Satan's charges when Satan said we're unfair and we are unjust. Or that when Satan said God was unfair and God was unjust, Jesus answered all those charges, saying that he indeed is love. Why doesn't God do something about the evil? He is. Jesus says, whatever you go through, I am going to strengthen you, enable you to handle it. The Christ who was born in the womb of Mary and conceived there in the womb of Mary by the Holy Spirit. The Christ that came and lived and vanquished Satan. The Christ that hung upon the cross. The resurrected Christ who is in heaven tonight for you and me is there. I love the old hymn. You know this old hymn, it says this. Just as I need him, Jesus is near. Just as I falter, just as I fear, just as I need him most, in the times of your deepest need, Jesus is there. But the book of Revelation does not end with the birth of Christ. It does not end with the life of Christ. It does not end with the resurrection of Christ. It does not end leaving Jesus in heaven and you and I on earth in the midst of sickness, suffering, and death. There is the end of the story. Just as the Bible began with a perfect world in Genesis, the Bible ends with a perfect world in Revelation. Just as the Bible began with the reign of God and the kingdom of Christ and the dominion of Jesus in Genesis, it ends with the reign of the kingdom of God in the book of Revelation. One day, Jesus will vanquish Satan forever. One day, all of evil, all of wickedness, all of the selfishness and greed and all of the problems of life will be over. The Bible says in Revelation 20, verse 10, the devil who deceived them. What is the devil? He is a deceiver. You see, the way of selfishness and the way of greed and hate is the way of death. Scientifically, we know that today. If you live a life of egotism, if you live a life of selfishness, scientists and those who study anatomy and physiology tell us that selfishness creates negative chemical byproducts that help to destroy the body, break down the immune forces, where kindness and love and generosity and unselfishness tend to send off positive chemical endorphins from the brain to build up the body. One day, love will reign in the universe. One day, Satan will be vanquished in the universe. One day, the deceiver who said that the way of selfishness and the way of greed and the way of lust and the way of having your own throne in your own heart to reign supreme in your own life. One day, all of that's going to be vanquished. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone. It says in Ezekiel chapter 28, 18 and 19, "Therefore I brought fire from your midst. It devoured you." One day, the glorious fire of God's presence. You know, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 13 that our God is a consuming fire. The love of God is like a consuming fire that in the end will consume all selfishness, all greed, all lust. Our God and His love will consume the devil, consume all evil. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 18 and 19. "And I turned you to ashes upon the earth. You shall be a horror and shall be no more forever." One day, the Bible pictures in the book of Revelation chapter 21, John says, "I, John, saw a holy city coming down from God out of heaven as a bride adorned for her husband. And a solemn announcement came." Yes, after a period of time that we'll study called the 1,000 years, and we'll study that in a future presentation. But at the end of all that, I want you to focus your mind today on the end of time. God takes this world. You know, the Bible says the meek shall inherit the earth. God takes this world pockmarked by sin. God takes this planet in rebellion. God takes this sinful earth, and God destroys all evil. He destroys all wickedness. The fire of His loving presence consumes all of the wickedness of Satan. And He makes this earth over just like it was, but much, much better in the Garden of Eden. His holy city comes down, and God dwells with His people, and He lives with His people forever and ever and ever and ever. There is no sin. There is no sickness. There is no suffering. There is no heartache. There is no death. There is no sorrow. There is no war. War and want and worry are over. Pestilence and pollution and poverty are over. Chaos and confusion and calamity are over. Disease and disaster and death are over. Over completely. One pulse of harmony and gladness, one pulse of joy, one pulse of love fills the whole universe. Never afraid again. No anxiety. No sorrow, no suffering. And with Jesus, we walk through the universe with our hearts filled with love. I long for that day, don't you? That day that all suffering and heartache will be over. Just this morning, I received a long-distance phone call from a very, very dear friend in America. Before I came, I had been on the phone with them regularly, 2-3 times a week. This young man is in his 40s. His dad's in his 60s. Just, we are about the same age. I've known his dad for 15, 16, 17 years. We've been friends. This friend of mine, man in his 60s, developed cancer. And the cancer was ravaging his body, and we'd be praying. He'd have his chemotherapy treatments, and I'd be praying for him before I came. And this morning, his son called me, and he said, "Mark, Dad's in the hospital, and the situation really does not look good. Would you just pray and pray and pray?" And I thought about my dear friend, strong, healthy man. And I thought about the fact that he's in the hospital, not able to think or function right now, just lying in that hospital bed, and that cancer is ravaging his body. And as I talked to his son, this is what I said to him. I said, "You know, I don't know what the results are going to be. God could work a miracle and raise your dad up, but He may not. He may allow your dad to sleep, to rest from pain and affliction until that day he comes again." But I called my friend by name and I said, "You know what? This we can be certain of. One day all this sickness is going to be gone. One day all this sorrow is going to be gone. And my friend said to me, if I didn't know that, I would give up. You see, what if you were an atheist? What if you had no belief in God? And you looked out over the world and you saw incredible suffering. How would you interpret it? How would you process it? Would you simply say, well, all of this world is just suffering and we're all going to suffer here and we're all going to die and we're just going to go into the grave and there's nothing beyond? Aren't you filled with despair? What if you're an atheist and you get a phone call like I did this morning and you don't believe in God? What do you say to your friend on the other end of the line? Oh, I'm so sorry, but your father's going to suffer terribly and he's just going to die and they're going to put him in the grave and it's just kind of a dark hole and you're going to have the funeral and it's all over and you'll never see your father again. What kind of hope is that? But to sense the hopeful message of the Word of God. The Bible does not deny human suffering. The Bible does not deny that even good people suffer. But it tells us that Jesus came to defeat Satan, that he revealed his love before the whole universe. It tells us that Christ right now is in heaven and he knows every ounce of suffering that we go through and that he will strengthen us in that suffering, that whatever we have to face, he's there by our side, that we're not alone in that suffering. And the Bible tells us that one day all suffering will be over and he will sweep the universe clean of all heartache, sorrow, and I look forward to that day, don't you? Let's pray. Father, in a world of suffering and heartache and sorrow, we thank you that you have already defeated Satan. We thank you that victory is certain. We thank you that we'll never have to face anything that you don't face with us. We thank you that you go through our suffering with us, that you're there to strengthen us and encourage us. And we thank you for the hope that one day all of the universe will be clean. That one day all of this sadness and suffering will be over. And Lord, that's enough for us. And until that day, we will cling to you in trust in Christ's name. Amen. And particularly for our satellite audience, thank you, satellite audience, for joining us. And I've heard that people are watching from Adelaide, watching from throughout Australia, Sydney, we have a group watching there, Brisbane, a group watching there. Special greetings to those of you that are watching by satellite as we sign off today. God bless you. See you next time.